Good evening, everyone. Welcome to UX and Data in our brand new space here at Workbench. So I'm really happy that Giorgia Lupi is here with us tonight. She's an award-winning information designer and artist. She's also the co-founder and design director at Accurat, a data-driven research, design, and innovation firm based in Milan and in New York. She's also the co-author of the project and book that led me to invite her here, Dear Data. So please welcome Giorgia Lupi.
Hi, everyone. Let me just get to my presentation. It should be here. Okay, thank you so much, Kim, for the introduction, and thank you for having me here. It's really a beautiful space, and I'm very excited to be part of this event. So yeah, just a little bit about myself before I get into the core of what I'll be talking about today. I am an information designer, originally trained as an architect. And of course, in my day job, I work with data. So I design charts, data visualizations, and interfaces that let people access data in a visual way. And as Kim was anticipating, I run a data visualization design company called Accurat, and I lead a team of designers, engineers, and data scientists. And what we do is we design and develop ways to make data and information more accessible through visual representations that are mostly interactive and digital. But personally, no matter what the final output is, I approach data in a very analog way. I always start from sketching. It is my way to make sense out of numbers without the limits that are imposed by software. And sketching with data and removing technology from the equation before bringing it back helps me focusing primarily on the nature of the data, their organization, and their deep meaning. And often, it also opens up new questions about the data themselves, leading to an iterative process of discovery. And sometimes this handcrafted approach to data produces kind of artifacts that are not necessarily what you would expect data set to be represented on, such as in this project I've been working on for the Malaria No More organization, where data has been used as a material to produce a narrative scarf telling the story of the fight against malaria over the last decade. But in my day job and with my company, I do indeed work with technology. This is just a pretty fast composition of some of our latest digital application. What we do is we work across many different industries, creating different kinds of interactive digital products. So we work with clients in the IT, healthcare, finance, telecommunication, or also with organizations such as the UN. And we create tools that really make data accessible both to internal and external audiences. I'll make just a few more specific examples to give you an idea of the variety of the project we do, and then I'll get into the core of the presentation. So we are right now working with a design team at IBM, and what we're doing for them is we are creating a building data visualization guidelines that will be applied to all of their future products. But not only good practices about how to visualize data in specific cases, most importantly, we're deeply researching on the great design heritage that IBM clearly has built over the years, thanks to working with brilliant designers such as Paul Rand or the Eames, to create a visual language for our data visualization guidances that is able to feel like IBM, to look uniquely as IBM, and that translates the visual principles we distilled in a way from their brand identity into core visual principle for building IBM data visualization language. Another different project we worked on last summer for the new site, The Intercept. You know, in that moment back in time when our biggest worries were email servers or maybe the very remote suspicion that someone was trying to influence government from the business world, big worries of 2016. But it made sense at the time. So for The Intercept, we designed an interactive journalistic piece visually exploring two very interesting data sets about the number of meetings at the White House with Google representative and the people involved in this meeting, which was the first data set. And most interesting, another related data set about who changed their job position going from Google to the White House and vice versa. So an interactive application for readers to explore alongside the article. Or another different but very experimental work that we've been doing for the Venice Biennial called Peninsula Talks, where we design and develop a multimedia interactive magazine around the stories of the people that are rewriting the notion and definition of Made in Italy, a digital experience that user can browse in a nonlinear way where we mixed video interviews, data, images, and other additional content, and where the core idea was actually to use data to provide a deep context for these interrelated stories. But today, I'm not just showing you what I do and how I do it, but most importantly, why I do it the way I do it. I want to share with you what I believe could be some of the key principles and challenges we will face in the data world in this very moment in time. But I want to start with a very important premise. In the last 10 years, a first wave of infographic data visualizations and minority report style dashboard produced sometimes great results, but some other time failed to represent what were the true meaning and stories and the potential behind the numbers. On the one hand, focusing too much on the technology aspect and the computing behind the data in creating overly complicated and sometimes illegible outputs or standard and not very meaningful widgets combined together. And on the other end, using visual design only as a cosmetic retouch of important and complicated issues in an attempt to make them look nicer or simpler than they are. But I believe that not all is bad in this after this sudden craze for data visualization. In fact, we now have a general audience, like even beyond the closed room of experts, that understand some of the tools needed to welcome what I will call a second wave of more meaningful, hopefully more meaningful and thoughtful data visualization, because I believe we are really in the beginning of this big revolution with and around data. So what I want to talk about today is what I'm starting to call data humanism, a new renaissance where we should aim to question the impersonality of a merely technological approach to data and to begin designing ways to reconnect numbers to what they really stand for, which are people, stories, ideas. Because the more ubiquitous data become, the more we need to experiment with how to make them unique, contextual, and intimate. And the way we visualize it is crucial because it's the key to translating numbers into something that we can relate to. So how do we do that? One of the most important challenges for data visualization to make sure we are going in towards this human direction is to experiment on finding proper ways to be faithful to complexity. Because our world is complex, and we should not see data visualization as a way to get rid of complexity. I would say the opposite. So if data can be a material to open people's eyes to new knowledge, it's really not realistic to avoid a certain level of complexity. So we can make a point with a single chart, maybe, but every important decision should be made on deep analysis, even when we talk about visual analysis. So typical client situation. Oh, it's too complicated. The top management will never read it. I want something simple they can get even without looking at the legend. So do we truly believe she's doing the best job for this for her company? And most importantly, who runs this kind of company? Do they make crucial decisions based on a super simplified dashboard? If they do, there soon won't be a company anymore. But if they don't, and if they still rely on like Excel and pages of report, well, her job is useless, so she'll be probably fired soon anyway. And it's like saying that the New York Times op-eds should be written in listicles because they work better for an easily distracted audience. But then how can we be faithful to complexity and facilitate an access to data? So most of the time, all of this conversation runs around layers of exploration. So layering both the data analysis and the visualization. Overview first, zoom and filter, then details on demand, says Ben Schneiderman, who is, of course, an expert in the data visualization world. And to this point, I want to show you a project of my company, Accurat, which it's not a very recent project, but I think it's still interesting to be showcased because it has been our playground to find our way to address complexity. It has been a two-year-long collaboration with La Lettura, which is the Sunday cultural supplement of Corriere della Sera, which is the main Italian newspaper. And from 2012 to 2014, we produced more than 40 data analyses and visualization that actually has been done in 4 days, as we started on a Monday and needed to finish on a Thursday. And we set up our method to create rich and very dense visuals with data on static pieces, like on printed pages, which is, of course, a challenge. How can you fit and render multiple stories in a single printed page. So what we did every week and just in a few days is we would find a topic that we wanted to explore. We would find our own data set, the main data set, and then we would also look for multiple tangential data set that could enrich and contextualize the main one that we were looking at in the beginning. And every time, as you can start seeing, we imagined and create a unique and very tailored visual model for the combination of our stories. And it was really trying to find a way to have interactivity in papers, so giving readers a different point of view to access the visualization. I'll just explain one of these around this first idea of complexity. This one that you see here explores the Nobel Prizes and Laureates from 1901 to 2012. And the main data set that we've been working with contained only the name of the laureates, the categories of the prize, and the year they received the prize. But you will see how we enriched the main data set and how we look for context to our first, you know, journalistic story. So we visualize the prize categories along a timeline within these parallel scores, highlighted by color. So we have red for chemistry, blue for economic science, green for physics, yellow for literature. I'm just saying them out loud in case you cannot see from the back. So purple for medicine and orange for peace. And each dot represents a Nobel laureate. And each guy is positioned according to the year the prize was awarded and his or her age at the time of the award, which we easily calculated given their date of birth. So highlighting how old you should be to win the prize. So per each category, we also drew a line indicating the average age for the category with the color of the category, and also the average age for the total of the laureates. So starting to highlight the differences between the categories and the differences in ages through time. We then used the main, say, axis of the visualization to provide some aggregated information. These arcs that you see here represent the principal universities of affiliation of the Nobel per each category and their distribution. So what we did is we took the total of the laureates, we picked the 7 most common universities, and then we went to see how many of our geniuses attended the top university. So it's interesting that chemistry, which is red, physics, which is green, and medicine, which is purple, are spread among the 7 main universities, while literature in peace, so yellow and orange, so the laureates quite didn't attend the top university. Then these bar charts here within these brackets represent their average grade level per category, and so if they were mostly PhD or not even degreed, and you can learn that if you want a Nobel in medicine or economic or physics, you should seriously think about a PhD, but you can try without it for literature in peace. We can see that a lot of laureates are not even degreed. So then the double rounded dot represent the women, actually not so many out of the total, and our design choice was very clear. We wanted to reduce the clutter visually because we could have added the double circle also around men and painted it blue, but we didn't because you get the distinction even if you highlight one of the two genders. So just to show back the whole piece before exploring the other part, so you recall where we are. And then the part below represents the most frequent hometowns out of the total, color per category, and aggregated per 30 year. And again, you can start seeing some interesting stories, like lately, if you're born in the US, you're most likely to catch the prize, while at the beginning of last century, the most of the scene was European. And I guess you really start seeing how many contextual information we added to the first data set to suggest possible interpretations. We also have some curiosity highlighted, some primates and particularly relevant information that we found. So personal story to show in a way a little more that these dots are human beings, like Marie Curie, who won 2 Nobel Prizes, and of course then the numbers are recalled in the visualization, or the oldest winner that was 90 and the youngest was 24, and so on. And finally, this is the how to read it part, when we used, again, the visualization main shape as a base to give readers information about how to play around. So it's really a quite rich piece, and you have to imagine that it was really printed very big in size, so people could really dig into the data. And so what we did here is we tried to render many overlapping and interplayable stories around the Nobel Prize history. It's not the ultimate point of view for sure, but as data journalists, as we were here, at least we provided multiple levels for readers to explore. So what I want to say with that, showing to you this very radical experiment, is that we can write rich and dense stories with data. And we can even teach the reader's eyes how to become familiar with visual languages that are able to convey the true depth of this complex story. And also dense and conventional data visualization that could promote slowness, a particularly poignant goal to set in our, you know, era of even shortening attention span. And I think that if we can create visuals that encourage engagement, people will slow down and do that. Another important point is around the importance of moving beyond standards, because as much as it sounds compelling, one size does not fit all, and definitely not in data. Another client situation we are very familiar with, can you make a D3 dashboard for me? So starting with the tool. I like the one with the circle and all of these lines inside. Well, there's probably something wrong here again, because too many projects are starting with the wrong question, starting with what the tools or the libraries of the technology can do. The one in red was the chart that our client was referring to, picked among a list of a very standard ones from D3, which you probably are all familiar with, but it's a JavaScript library for building dynamic interactive data visualization. And don't get me wrong, D3 and all that it has done to our community of data visualization is really amazing. I'm not questioning the tool itself, I'm questioning the approach. Because my point here is that many times the right way to make sense of information is not to load data into a tool, pick among a list of suggested charts, and then maybe just tweak the final result and make it look nicer or a little different. This is the easy way, but I think it's not really the best. So when we started Accurat, we were in a very strange place because we were a data visualization company with no developers. And what you can see here are actually some of the steps that created the visualization you've seen before. So the only skills that we had among our team were limited to organizing and analyzing data in Excel, and then creating data visualization made entirely by hand using Adobe Illustrator. So no presets, no automation, no shortcuts, just hours spent on Excel macros and manually positioning hundreds of elements in Illustrator. So in a way, we always started with a blank page. And because of these limitations, our focus was primarily on the content and on representing this information in ways we imagined from scratch, specifically for that case, and specifically for the analysis that we performed on the data. And this made our representations very unique to the data we were working with, truly representing them and them only. Well, if you have to do it by hand, why not doing something different every time? It might sound naive, but I believe there is more to that. I believe there is a true value in designing visual representations that are very specific to the context and the data you're working with. And this is for many reasons. For example, when you're producing a 50-page long revenue analysis, if everything looks the same, the audience will be kind of confused. So I'd say there is a big benefit in clearly differentiating these two charts. What do you think? They're both appropriate, but together they look confusing because they use the same visual representation to represent two completely different things. And I have nothing against bar charts. The same can be said also for the other charts, the one that our clients like the most nowadays. They use the same model to represent completely different types of data. So coming back to how we work and how what we believe in our company, once we eventually started to bring developers in, our approach was already led by design. So in a way, we still create very custom visualization every time, even when we work interactively. Well, and of course, engineers at Accurat hate the designers as a consequence, but this is for another talk. So even now that the 90% of what we do is digital and interactive, and even now that we're half in half designers and engineers, we still never start from standards. We always, in a way, start from a blank page, and more specifically to what the data we're working with tell us. Another thing that might sound obvious, but I think it's worth saying it out loud, is to remember that data is not only numbers. We should always take into consideration what data stands for and what numbers actually represent in their context, and keep it in mind always. To this regard, a few years ago, a very peculiar challenge was proposed to my team by this woman, Samantha Cristoforetti. She has been the first Italian woman astronaut, and she contacted us before being launched on a 6-month-long expedition to the International Space Station. So she told us, "I'm going to space, and I want to do something meaningful with the data of my mission to reach out to people." Best client ever, by the way. So a mission to the ISS comes with terabytes of data about anything you can possibly imagine. The orbits around Earth, the speed and position of the ISS, and all of the other thousand live streams from its sensors. A technology-driven approach would have taken us far from anything meaningful. This is exactly what we didn't want to do, and who needs this? So we had everything we could possibly imagine, but why would any of this really matter? People are not interested in data for the sake of it. Because numbers are never the point, they are the mean, and the story that we wanted to tell is that there is a human being in a tin box flying in space above your head, and you can actually see her with your naked eye in a clear night. So we decided to use data to create a connection between Samantha and all of the people looking at her from below. We designed and developed a web application called Friends in Space that simply let you say hello to Samantha when she was orbiting above you, and hello to all of the other people who were online at the same time from all over the world. And all of these hellos left a visible mark on the map as Samantha was flying by, and she was actually waving back at us every day using Twitter from the ISS. And actually, this made people see the mission's data from a very different perspective. It all suddenly became much more about our human nature and our curiosity rather than technology. So data powered the experience, but a very simple and human interaction was the drive. And the very positive response of its thousands of users taught me a very important lesson, that working with data means transforming the abstract and the uncountable into something that can be seen, felt, and reconnected to our lives, something that is hard to achieve if we let technology lead us in the process. Then, well, data is not enough. Lately, in our community, and also in the very first point that I've made today, we've been talking about context being equally important as the primary data set to make sense of information. Because the more machine and applications will be gathering data from us and for us, the more we have to stick a post-it in our heads to remind us to always need context in, especially when data is about people. Because we shouldn't expect computers or apps to tell us something really revealing about ourselves and our lives without an active effort on our part. So in a time when sensor, web cookies, and self-tracking applications are proliferating, we really have to actively engage in making sense of this data within its original context, especially as we visualize it. So I want to bring up this personal project here that Kim was referring to before. It was a research project on my side, a very radical and zero technological project that has been, for me, the big data hungover cure. Called Dear Data. It was a collaboration with information designer Stefanie Posavec. So I'm an Italian and I live in New York, and Stefanie is American and she lives in London. And we only met a few times in our life, but we decided to work together because we found out we have many personal and work similarities. Well, we're both expat, or let's say proud immigrants. we're both the same age. I'm not going into details about that. We're also both only children, very self-absorbed and self-centric, but most importantly, we both work with data in this very handcrafted way, trying to add a human touch to the world of computing and algorithm, preferring drawing as opposed to coding as the entry point to getting to know our numbers. And, you know, we are just definitely both obsessed to sketching with data and drawing with data. So we start a year-long hand-drawn data correspondence across the Atlantic, where every weekend for 1 year, we used our personal data to get to know each other. Personal data around weekly shared mundane topics, from our complaints to the interaction with our partners, from the compliments we received to the sounds of our surroundings. So 52 pretexts in form of data to investigate and reveal a particular aspect of ourselves and about our days. Personal data that we would then manually hand-draw on a postcard-sized sheet of paper. So data postcard that we will send every week from New York to London and from London to New York. So eventually the postcard arrived at the other person's address with all of the scuff marks of its journey over the ocean. And we purposely designed the initial constraint for the card, so the front of the postcard contains only no text or explanation at all. It is hopefully a beautiful drawing that one could just take as an illustration if you didn't know that there are data behind. And the back of the card contains the address of the other person, of course, the title of the project, and the legend, so how to read our drawings. And we didn't send each other any digital scan of our card, so we've been both eagerly waiting to get the weekly data portrait of the other person on our mailbox for over 1 year, also rediscovering the pleasure of checking the postbook as you get home. It has been a type of slow data, small data, and incredibly analog data transmission. So during a time when everybody talks about big data, virtual reality, we of course do small data and physical postcards. Well, it doesn't sound very revolutionary, but by removing technology from the equation, we were really forced to extend ourselves as designers. Because on the one hand, we've each been forced to invent 52 different visual languages as hand drawing with data leads you to design that are incredibly tailored and customized to the data that you're working with. But also removing the computer from the equation triggered us to find different ways to look at data as excuses to tell something about ourselves. In fact, as we gathered our weekly data, the process was definitely more labor-intensive than just deriving standard metric from technological devices. We've been conceiving Dear Data from the beginning more as a personal documentary through data than a quantified self-project. For example, the very first week of Dear Data, we actually choose a pretty cold and not very personal topic. How many times do we check the time in a week? And here is the front of my card, and you can see that every little symbol represents all of the time that I check the time, position per days and per hours, chronologically, nothing really complicated here. But you see in the legend how I added anecdotal details about this moment. In fact, the different instances of my symbol indicates why I was checking the time. What was I doing? Was I bored? Was I hungry? Was I late? Did I check it on purpose or just casually glanced at the clock? And this is the key part, giving Stefanie an idea of my days through my data collection, something that is not possible if you don't actively add meaning to your tracking. Stefanie and I spent 1 year collecting our data manually instead of relying on cell tracking digital application, and we've done it by hand to force us to focus on what computers cannot gather, or at least not yet. In fact, we figure we also can find data in our minds and in the words we use, and not only in our activities, like at week number 3 where we track the thank yous we said and received. And when I realized that I thank mostly the people that I don't know, and I definitely don't thank enough the ones who are close to me, where the process of actively noting and counting these types of action became a sort of ritual and actually changed ourselves, because we became much more in tune with ourselves and aware of our surroundings and how our behaviors. But we also ventured into more negative sharing, like in week 7 where we mapped our complaints and I composed this musical complaint card, borrowing a very visual, literal visual inspiration from the music notation system to show the repetitiveness of my complaints over time. And I then added details about their type, but also their loudness, their level. Did I truly need to complain? Of course, figuring out that most of my complaints were totally avoidable. But we also discovered that we can even find data beyond the daily tracking and make a survey of what we own, for example. Walk into our closets with the eyes of the data collector and looking for data in the way we categorize and classify our garments. How often do we wear them? Which is very telling of one's personality. And, well, again, deeply realizing what could have been pretty clear from the beginning, this is just a visualization of the most interesting revelation from analyzing my closet that I share with my boyfriend. Or we can also imagine to try to use data to become better human beings for at least 1 week and perform actions to then be able to report them. Like this week where we purposely smile to strangers and we track their reaction, if they smiled back or if they pretended they didn't notice. But besides the topic that we chose every week, most importantly, we've been really adding contextual details to our logs, and that was the only way to make them truly personal about us and us only. While I'm not saying that everyone should do a hyper-personal project and has their data, I think that data visualization designers can anyway make their work much more relevant by spending more time with any type of data and finding any possible way to deeply understand their context. Because data is a tool that filters reality in a very subjective way, and data has this unique power to abstract the world and can help us understand it according to different but relevant factors every time. So Dear Data was a personal project that led to many exhibitions and eventually to a book, and that found the most exciting home as the original set of our card became part of the permanent collection of the Museum of Modern Art, which of course we are incredibly proud today. But beside this joy, Dear Data was a personal exploration that has been so well received, so incredibly well received. We've been seeing hundreds of people who learned about the project and wanted to experiment on themselves, and even teachers of any grade, even primary school and secondary school, that are using this format to teach their students the world of data. So it opened the idea of data to a wider audience in a way, because it made it more approachable and more understandable and easily relatable to their daily life. Which isn't the ultimate goal of what we do here as people who work with data, to try to speak as much as possible beyond the rooms of expert. So yeah, this is why I believe we have to reclaim a personal approach to how all kind of data is captured and displayed, and proving that subjectivity and context really play a big role if we want our audience to truly engage with the stories of data. And proving that in any case, data is primarily human-made, and how a data set is collected and created, and the information included and not included, directly determines the course of its life. So finally, and this is my last point for today, let's remember that data is imperfect because it's primarily human-made. And if it comes from a sensor, well, a human designed and built that sensor. So data-driven doesn't mean unmistakably true. It never did and probably never will. But then we should also change how we conceive the visual representations of data and learn how to render the more qualitative and nuanced aspects of data, and even the imperfection and approximation. There is a value in visualizing something that is good, data that are good enough, because they still might tell a story. But then we need to avoid focusing too much on the exact numbers and approaching the problem from a different perspective. So to this point, I'll show you a project that we released before the election. It's called WordPotos, and you still can find it online at wordpotos.com. We were still very optimistic here. So we teamed up with Google Trends to create a fun web application that visualized the search interest in the two candidates, Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, for the US presidential elections, and the main issues in their political platform. So what people Google the most, according to like one candidate and their topics, but outside the US. So we are looking at how much the rest of the world search for Hillary or for Trump, and for them in association with the hottest topic of their campaigns. So what was the world interested in? What did they care about? So you can look at the world outside the United States at the continental or at the country level, and you can always bring in the value for the US to have a vague but indicative sense of scale. And you can see the bubbles arranged by similarity in search behavior, or by geography, or also by recent trends falling or rising. And to put everything in context, we also, every topic came with a quote from the candidate that gives a little more information on his or her position on the matter. But the question here is, was it by any means a precise measure of the country's interest in a topic? Not at all, but still it told us something. So opinions on such delicate topics are most time a fluid and always moving blob in a way. So this is why we decided to represent it this way. It's not a perfect description of reality, as the Google Trend Index just gives us a hunch of the general interest for the topic in the country. So in situations of this kind, it doesn't really make sense to read if a bubble's value is 52 or 57. It's just a big bubble, that's it. Our goal here has never been to represent people's has always been to represent people's interest in the topic, and not simply the index or the number that has been used to measure that. So with those focused on a softer depiction of data that looks imprecise and fuzzy, imperfect as the data are. So despite the idea that data visualization should always be rigorous and precise, I really think that in certain cases we can go for a softer depiction of data that faithfully renders the fluidity and fuzziness of, and as in this case, as conversation are. So a sort of deliberately imperfect visual to grasp and display a meaningful and rich but very humane data set. So to start my conclusion, I think that we should consider data, whole kind of data, as the beginning of the conversation and not the end, because data alone will not give us a solution. So we all look at these numbers, percentages, and electoral map, and we think that they are the final answers to our doubts and fear, but they hardly are. So why the word humanism? In the Renaissance, humanism, European intellectual put an end to the dark medieval time by placing the human nature instead of God at the center of their view of the world. And I believe something similar needs to happen with the world of data. Now, apparently data are treated like God, but a real revolution will only come when we will stop thinking that data are infallible truth, because it will never be a complete representation of reality. And I think that a real change will happen when we will stop representing number alone, and we will instead start capturing what this number stands for, which is always a complicated, confusing, and messy reality. And doing this doesn't mean stepping away from technology. I think it means designing new ways to include empathy, imperfection, and human qualities in how we collect, interpret, and display data. I really envision a renaissance where data are truly for everybody, but also unique to anyone, and where ultimately, instead of using data only to become more efficient, we will all try to use data to become more humane. Thank you. If there are questions, I'm really happy to answer.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm curious as to what inspires you to present your stories, each one, based on the data you receive.
Mm-hmm. You mean visually inspires or inspired by the data?
Both.
So, yeah, I think that first of all, and I can speak about we, because we in my company, I mean, most of the projects that you've seen, we've been doing it as a team. First of all, it's like really trying to understand what is the main story or stories that the data will tell us. And so first of all, what we would do every time is try to draft different possible first visual models to really understand the different possibilities that we have to tell the story. Then once we find the most compelling one according to the goal at hand, and I'm specifically talking about journalistic projects such as the first one, when we in a way need to find a point of view because we will act as the journalist there. Then once we find the main story, we want to make sure that the first, I would say the architecture of a visualization or the layout, faithfully represent that stories. And after that, we can layer the details visually. And I think that visually, I am personally, and this is very personal, I'm very inspired by visual languages that are sort of like already formalized and conventional, such as the aesthetic of music notation or abstract art, something where I can derive principle that I can then translate to my drawings. But then this is true for all of the project when, again, we act as a journalist. But what we do most often is really providing people and our clients with tools that they can use to explore data themselves. So what I've been showing you here mostly are projects that are, in a way, has a point of view as we as storytellers. But I think that right now the 90% of our work is to be as neutral as possible and provide really ways for our clients to explore their data visually. Thank you. Yeah.
I'll stand up since I'm in the back.
Cool.
So I'm interested in any of these projects, did you run into situations where the sources of the data conflicted with each other, right? Because you were talking about like the part of this being a human thing,
yeah.
Part of it being a story thing, is that, right, maybe there are situations where like two different people are observing the same phenomenon, or maybe there's some kind of device that's supposed to record something automatically, but like one of them is reading differently. Did you encounter situations like that? And if you did, what did you have to do about it?
Well, I think that representing data is always subject to an interpretation. So any way that we decide to then, for example, be faithful to one source or another is just a choice as a data visualization designer. The thing that I find we are most lucky for is that we always work with clients that are expert in their domain, and so they would be the one telling us according to the different domain that we're working with. For example, if we work with the healthcare system, we work with expert in the field, or if we work with finance, we work with banks, and so they are expert in their field. And so it would be mostly up to them to understand according to their knowledge and their hypotheses, and also according to what maybe the first draft of our visualization tell them, in this specific case, what would be the most, I would say, trustworthy data set to visualize? Or sometimes it just happened that you visualize both, and it, you just like provide two different stories according to the source. And I think that's how it works for us. Thank you for your questions.
Oh, I'm over here, sorry. I'll stand up as well.
Yeah.
It's a great talk, thank you.
Thank you.
And, so my question is about the ambiguity of the representation of this data. Mm-hmm. So something that has always sort of nags at me whenever I work on a visualization or anything of that nature, that it's hard to represent error mm-hmm. in the data set itself. And I'm wondering also how that overlays in your work, representing the error in the underlying data set, margins of error, fundamental measurement issues, missing data, that kind of thing.
Yeah, I think it really depends on the specific case. There are visual models that are even just the normal bar charts when you then have, for example, just another line that indicates the margin of error. So if the uncertainty of the data set is really part of the data set itself, so if it's really, I think, inherent to what you're visualizing, it is very, very important to make it really clear. And so visualizing the uncertainty as part of the visualization, I think that otherwise it's really just important to say it somewhere. And so, for example, if there are missing data points that you decide to not display in the first place because you are aggregating this data, then there should be something that will recall people to understand that, okay, this is the first story that you shape, but then here there was a missing data point, for example. Every case is very different, but it happened to us, even with analytics, that we really used the visualization itself to show where there are margins of errors. And you can use very different visual models, such as like the cones that opens up different perspective, or really adding to a bar chart a little chart which is a margin of error, or just a point that gets you to the very center and you understand what is the other margin of error. So it also depends on the goal. For example, on the very first project that I showed you, the journalistic one, our goal was to entertain people. And so, of course, we were telling stories about cultural and social phenomena. And so, in this case, every visualization was accompanied by an article. And so we could even use the text to explain if, for some reason, we did some aggregation in the data. I believe it's really, truly important to find a way to communicate it, whether it's visually or with the text. I think it's really a very nice space to experiment, the one of how you visualize uncertainty and errors. There have been some experiments, but I think especially in academic contexts, right? So I don't know if I really answered to your question, but. Thanks. Yeah, I don't know. Well,
I think right here.
Okay, but she has a mic. Cool.
I have two questions, if that's okay.
Yeah.
My first question is, you mentioned that you were thinking of your project as a kind of documentary, I believe, mm-hmm. versus quantified self. And I'm wondering, how do you see those two things as different?
So I think that if you look at the quantified self movement and what is normally recognized as quantified self, it mainly, not necessarily always, but it mainly relies on tracking applications that will track things about yourself, and you will be the passive, in a way, the passive person who sees all of this data about you, but it's not something that you actively track. So you would have the number of steps, the quality of your sleep, I don't know, the path of your running experience and whatever, but it's not something that you actively input as you experience your activity. And I think that to us, we called it personal documentary to, in a way, recall more of the idea of a data diary. Right, when we will write our stories for the day through the pretext of the data collection. So it is this is how we kind of like came up with this personal documentary thing. I think it was really like a shared diary through data more than just, I don't know, experiences, self-tracking digital application that will track us as opposed to being the active tracker. So that is why.
I hear a lot of times people talk about, I'm not a data visualization mm-hmm. person myself, but I talk to a lot of people in this space, and people often make a distinction between data art and data visualization.
And the art piece feels acceptable even within the context of entertainment, for instance. But the more serious the data is, the more precise the constraints become.
Sure. I'm not very, very much into these types of definitions because the boundary is really fuzzy. And I believe that something can be an artistic data visualization or a rigorous data visualization or just a data visualization. I just don't feel, I don't come from an academic background and I don't really feel the urge to have this distinction. Normally, what I noticed, like by reading things about data visualization, is that people call data art the pieces that has not a clear functional purpose. So it's just something that maybe you experience as a beautiful piece, and then you know that there are data behind it, but you're not necessarily so keen to understand what are the data. While maybe data visualization is something where it needs to be very clear with a key, with a legend, or with an explanation what the data representations are. So in a way, of course, in a work of art, it's not that the artist will write down like below the art piece, well, this line would stand, you know, for that sensation. So I think that the distinction that normally is now working is this distinction, but I don't know, I don't really find very meaningful to spend time debating on this distinction. I'm talking about a lot of posts online that are really debating. Also, like, I remember one person who talked about Dear Data, about the fact that she was like, I really hope that these two women wanted to do a data art project, because I will like it if I knew that the data art was the purpose, but if they wanted to do something functional, well, then no. And I'm like, well, if you like it, you like it. If you don't like it, you don't like it. And I just don't find really interesting to talk about definitions.
Questions on this side of the room?
I really enjoyed your talk.
Thank you.
I see at least a dichotomy, if not a paradox. I'm just wondering, every time we tell a story, whether it's in prose or in figures, we have a point of view.
Mm, yeah.
That said, I'm concerned about this question of, do you have concerns over the letting the data speak for itself versus the point of view biasing this, and how do you reconcile between those?
Yeah, I guess it like that went back to how I answered to the other question. So it depends on whether you're building, to me, a static data visualization, so something that, of course, you need to pick a point of view because you need to visualize this data and they will be static and representing in this kind of way and they will live there forever, or if you're building an interactive tool for data discovery. So when you produce a static piece, of course, you will act as a journalist because you need to decide what to include and what to leave out, and it will be, of course, biased by your choice. And you will be telling a possible story about the phenomenon, not the ultimate point of view, but a possible story. And I think that this needs to be very clear. It is a concern, but it is the only way we can do static data visualization, I think. While when you build something interactive that will use data visualization to let people explore the data in really a more, in a way that they can filter, change the view, maybe modify some parameters, I think that then you are more neutral and you can really be a facilitator for people that are not probably expert in programming or with statisticians' ability to explore data in a visual way. So I see that their data visualization, when it's interactive and when people can play with the parameters, can really help non-expert to find their own point of view, find their own story, and maybe getting to their own biases. But I understand your concern. It is, you know, it works with everything, as you said before, with any kind of journalistic piece, storytelling, or yeah, with everything. Even the way we talk about, you know, right now, you have a point of view, you can have a bias, you can tell your story from your point of view. I think it's just, you know, everything in the world that is subjective, even data. Hi.
Over here, we've got a question.
Yeah.
Hi. Hello.
Oh,
thank
sorry.
You for your talk. Work more on the data analytics side of things, but I'm trying to get more into data visualization. But I'm still curious. So now that you have engineers at Accurat, I'm curious as to, one, what backend data repositories you they work with, and two, for like the data manipulation tools, if you use some other software or if that's in-house software that you're developing now.
Okay, so to this point, I want this question to be taken by Gabriel, who is my partner at Accurat, who is definitely much more skilled on the technological side, as I am a designer and an engineer.
I'd say that we don't use the same tools all over again. We mostly have JavaScript developers in our team, so we have now 6 developers who are focusing mostly on front-end. 2 of them have a business experience in back-end technologies, so they use what it's easier for them. So one of them has a background working with Java, for example, and that works for him. When we work on the back end of our projects, it's mostly JavaScript. So I believe that for the type of company we have, we usually integrate with external teams when we have bigger IT integration projects. So being a team of 20 people, including designers, it's very rare for us to actually handle big loads of data directly. So for example, when we work with banks, we integrate with a team of 50 developers working on their backend, and we negotiate the intermediate layers that let their systems speak to ours. So we define like an API structure and whatever the technology they use to build the backend aspects, we integrate with it. We're starting to deal directly with big data technologies, so working directly with Hadoop, coding in Scala, and whatever is needed, but for the type of company we are, I don't see us growing in that direction, because we will never have enough people to deal directly with those things. And for simpler projects, we just run a MySQL database or Neo4j, depending on the type of data we have, but very simple technologies that we can host on our machines or on an Amazon machine. So when the data becomes too much, it's usually not us working on it, but we.
I was noticing in the beginning you were presenting the development of your visualizations, pencil and paper, mm-hmm. basically. I was wondering if that you found that you think that the influence of using hands and paper and pencil type thing is makes it better for thinking, rather than using the tool of any kind,
yeah.
which I think tends, my senses and my experiences, that tends to interfere with the actual thinking process as mm-hmm. opposed to the actual development process.
Yeah, I think it's very personal, but like for me, I cannot code, and I cannot code because I don't code, and because when I started to think, oh, I can learn how to code, then we brought developers in the company and it didn't make sense for me to learn. And what I do is very laborious, so the things that you said that you saw before, even not the sketches, were really made by hand. I would use Excel and Illustrator, a very laborious process, and I feel that to me, I always say that when I sketch with the data in my head but not in my pen. So I'm definitely influenced much more on the shape of the data and on what is truly a visual model that can even be invented, that can faithfully represent the data. To me, it's really freeing my mind, and it's just the way I work. But I know that there are a lot of, some of our developers are very, very skilled and they can think while coding. So what I was questioning before when I was talking about going beyond standards, it's not necessarily that people need to start sketching, they can even start coding, but maybe it's too easy to just like load your data into a tool that returns you with very standard charts and then the work is done. So I think that there's more to that. And to me, sketching definitely opens up possibilities. I know that it's possible even with code, it's just not my thing. But I totally agree. Well,
the reason I was saying, just to emphasize, is that I was reading and sensing that when you write, mm-hmm. Typing doesn't promote thinking as much as
I agree. There's a tactile quality with pen and paper that to me it still it still has opened my mind much more than typing or placing lines in Illustrator. I don't know if I mean it's personal, but yeah, to me it's definitely like that.
Yeah. I think that's all the time we have tonight, because I know Giorgia has to head out to another event. So let's give her another round of applause.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for being here.